We're so glad you're with us this morning. We hope that you join us in worship and praise. Man, we're very excited that you're going to start seeing people in the building. So we're jazzed about that. We just want you to join us, worship, lift up the King of Kings. desire to lift you up, for people to come face to face with you. Help us, Lord God, to release ourselves to you, to allow you to take us, for you to make our hearts like your own. We give you thanks because you're good. Lord God, we want to be made like you.
sing, it is well with my soul. My God is still in control. My God is still in control.
Guess no person in this building more important than you. Our heart's cry is not that people will be pleased, but that people will be introduced to you. You're the guest. You're the master of the ceremony. Lord, it's our heart's desire that you be the true master of our hearts and our lives. Lord, we don't want to play church. We want to be the church. We don't want to do church, but rather we want to share the message and build your kingdom. Father God, I pray that this season produces for your kingdom. And Lord God, regardless of what the world does, what the world says, our heart's desire is to be truly your people, building your kingdom, seeing you touch lives. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, hey, good morning, Faith Bible Chapel and friends. I want to welcome you to really kind of part two of a series that I've started about getting or some gain from the pain, talking about how do we gain from this time and this whole COVID situation now that has morphed into the tension that we see in our streets. I'm borrowing very heavily from Andy Stanley and the series that he has started called Better For It. And so I want you to be with me here because I really think that, you know, as we go through this whole thing, it's so important to realize that, number one, we're all going to go through the pain of this season and we're all experiencing it. And, you know, for my wife and I, this has been a very serious season and we've taken some hits. And I know a lot of you have taken hits. Some of you, I'm so sorry that you've taken really hard hits. And But with that, you know, it's in the midst of this that we're looking forward. And I think it would be such a shame that if we looked forward and said, man, I just can't wait for things to go back to the way they were. It would be such a loss, I think, and such a waste if we just go right back to same old, same old. And I mentioned this last week. And so, and I think part of the problem here with this, and especially those of us who have really been rocked in one way or another, and I think at a level, this whole nation is being rocked through just this chain of events. And if you don't think that God is up to something when you see event after event after event in 2020, if you don't think that there's something to that, then I just don't understand how you could be there. Because number one, it's just one thing after another. I really believe God is trying to get our attention and do something meaningful for any of us and all of us who are willing in the season. So with that, you know, I want to bring up something because this, I think this is really where things come down to the crux of the matter, is I think that for all of us, especially those of us who are believers, but I think those of us who are even considering becoming a believer or have dealt with the issue, it always comes down to a couple of things. God, are you really there? Second, are you really good? And it's really dealing with that question. And some people, because of the evil and the violence and that we see in the world, we conclude that God is either not there or if he's there, he's not really good. And I think the sad part is that I've made decisions to do good, and I've, especially earlier in my life, but still even on occasion, I make decisions to do evil. And I think for me, you know, it's so easy to blame God, but the truth of the matter is we got to take responsibility for what we do. And so rather than blame God, I try to own my own. But here's the thing is that when we're dealing with who God is, I think one of the biggest struggles, especially for believers or those who are considering believing, is that I think almost every one of us at one time or another in our life, we've experienced some level of abandonment. I think most of us have been abandoned at one time or another by a friend or a loved one. And those leave a mark. And so I want to share with you a fun story. This isn't a bad story, but I want to share you a little story about abandonment. And it happened when I was a new believer. I was 17 when I gave my life to the Lord. I'd moved from the Poconos of Pennsylvania to Denver area and Arvada, and I was introduced to Faith Bible Chapel, and I was saved there. 17 years old, and so me and some of my new Christian buddies, I'm part of the youth group, and I took to it, and the group just welcomed me in with open arms. And so several of us guys, four of us, we go to a theme park, and so we're just having a good day at the park, and we go into the to the spook house, right? And so we go into the spook house, and there's six of us. And so, and unbeknownst to me, and I saw the guys talking, and I remember seeing that. I'm 17, and so what they talked about, there's six of us, and so we got two at a person per cart. So those little carts with the little rail, you know. So two of us got in the front one, and I was one of the two in the front one. And so basically, I didn't know it, but they'd set it up to where when we got going, they would basically, you know, they said, okay, when we get to this point, everybody get out of the cart. So we got out of the cart, and then they set it up to where they filled the last two carts. The first one was gone, and they left me in there. It was a setup. So here I am. I'm in the spook house. I'm 17, and I am just left there in the spook house. They all got back in. I looked at them, and they said, don't worry. We'll come back, and we'll get you in a bit. And so I'm stuck there in the spook house waiting for my friends. And, of course, they said, you know, the whole point was that, you know, they would go in full, and one would come out empty, and woo. Well, that wasn't really the deal. That was the setup so that they could leave me abandoned. So I'm here in the spook house. And I'm looking around, and it, you know, it's a spook house. It's creepy. And people are going by, and it just so happened, this was back when bib overalls were all the rage, and I was wearing bib overalls, and I had a t-shirt. Just so happened that both were a very dark blue. And I'm there in the spook house, and I'm, of course, between a couple of monsters there, you know, out of sight, because I'm hiding so that I don't get busted, right? And as I'm doing that, somebody is going through, and I think it was a girl, and she looked over her left shoulder, and she saw me there, and she shrieked. And as she was, as that cart was going, you know, the light bulb went pop, and I started hiding and jumping out and scaring people. And I mean, it was a riot. I'm in there, and I'm scaring all these people, and my friends were talking about being out there in line, and they're back in line, and people are coming out, and they're screaming, somebody's in there, somebody's, and I'm just having a ball. Unfortunately, they didn't send anybody in looking, but man, I mean, one guy took a swing at me when I scared him, and he just barely touched me, but I'm glad he didn't have another inch, because I would have probably had a broken nose, But man, it was just so wild, though, to be abandoned there. And fortunately for me, you know, that was something that could have been really a negative thing, but it turned out to be a positive. But unfortunately, the truth of the matter is many of us have felt abandoned, and we've been in much more sensitive situations than that. Some of us, that abandonment actually has its origin in losing a parent when we're young, or a parent that just basically left and was never part of your life. It can come from so many different angles, where friends or a spouse can just up and leave. And those things, unfortunately, they leave a lasting impression. The pain that we experience from abandonment never completely goes away. And I think a lot of what we deal with when we deal with God, especially since it's not like you can just, you know, show up at the door, knock, and have this face-to-face conversation, I think that we really struggle with the idea of, God, are you there? Can I trust you to be there when I need you? And those things really come into play. And so I think when we deal about, you know, where is the gain? How can we gain from the pain of the season? One of the places that some people, because of what we've been through and experienced, is that we try to basically, we tend to frame that in the idea that, well, God just isn't there. And those of us who have made it a point to pursue him, we're going to have to face that issue if we're going to have pain or gain for all this pain. And so with that, I want you to follow me, and I want to take you, remind you a little bit from last week. You know, we asked some really important questions, and one of the questions we asked is, what am I doing? You know, one of the things that, because we're going through this time, and we're maybe taking some hits, and things aren't so settled for us, you know, some of us are starting to realize that, you know what, I've been doing some things that are sabotaging me. And so we asked that question last week, is what am I doing that is basically causing me, setting me back? And I think it's important that during this painful period that we look at ourselves, what am I doing that sets me back? What am I doing that actually, you know, in my experience, I've always been my worst enemy. Nobody has set me back farther than what I've set me back. And so it's important to be honest with ourselves and to take a hard look and say, you know what, I've got some things in my life that set me back, that sabotage me. And during this time, maybe we've had to face those things. We asked that question last week. Last week, we asked a second question. You know, what do I need to start doing that I should have been doing all along? And one of the things that we really took a hard look at is financially. You know, we tend to spend what we have. And unfortunately for Americans, we have a tendency to not only spend what we have, but we spend of what we haven't earned yet. And so we end up deeply in debt. And with that debt, we pay interest. And so, you know, many of us really wish we'd saved more money. And I mean, I'm thankful that we were able to save some money before we came into this season. And we've had some good disciplines. And so we looked at that. You know, we've asked ourselves what we've struggled with as far as how am I as a person? What am I struggled with, you know, that I see about who I am? What cracks have I seen in me and my character? We've also, because of this quarantine and whatnot, we've dealt with relationships. How am I, you know, what's my relationship like? Do I have a friends? Do I have a network of friends that I can count on? Do I have a family network that I can contact? I know my brother and I, we're very close, and we talk a lot. And, you know, but even with your marriage or with your children, we find these relational cracks. And, of course, the one that we started with, finances. And a lot of us have been hit hard financially. And it doesn't mean it's all our fault, but it does mean that we have choices. I love what Andy Stanley says. He says, wishing doesn't change anything. We have to engage these questions. If we want to gain from all this pain, we're going to have to take a really serious look at how we have been dealing with things, how we deal with life, and who we are, and how we function. We got to be brutally honest with ourselves. And that's probably one of the toughest things that we have to deal with is brutal honesty when we look in the mirror. But with that, it's followed by this. And I think it's important that you understand that we as human beings across all the different divides of life that and that don't have to be divisions, but in this, no matter where we're from or our culture, all of us universally, we have this incredibly powerful gift. Or at least it can be a gift. And that's simply this, that we can learn and grow from any event that life throws at us. And I want you to realize that you know, I was talking about abandonment earlier. We learn things in the midst of any crisis, and we take away something whether we do it intentionally or not. That's not the issue. God has programmed us and set us up to where we respond to things or we react to things, and we come away with any given crisis, trauma, or even good event. We learn things in the midst of this, and we carry that with us. Learning isn't the issue. The real question is, in that learning, and what we take away from a situation is that what we take away or does what we take away cause us to be better people as a result of it? Or does what we take away from any given crisis or situation or trauma cause us to grow to be more bitter people? Huge question. How do we respond? What's our tendency? I was just sharing with Pastor Al just a little bit ago, is that, you know, my biggest enemy all my life has been self-pity. And because I tend to indulge in self-pity, I had this way of my takeaway from given situations was basically poor me. This is how life sabotaged me. And you know, I'm stuck. It's so important that you and I understand, and one of the things that the Lord has done for me that has been one of the biggest let me out of prison is when I started to understand that I have the power to decide whether I come away positive with gain or I come away bitter. So whether I come away better or bitter, my choice. Every situation. And it's important for you to understand the same, is that you have a choice of how you come out of this long, dark tunnel that we have been in, it seems like, for so long now. You know, the truth of the matter is, whoever you are, you know, none of us can control what life throws at us. That's just reality. We don't control life. But here's the thing, is that while we can't control what happens to us, we do control, and we do have a choice as to where any given event takes us. It's our choice. It's our choice whether I choose to use this to get better or I choose to use this to get bitter. And it would be so nice if it was natural for us to go the better route. But the thing is that it all comes down to us. And this is really when we start to take it down to the next level, getting down towards roots, is that we have to choose. And this is where it gets tough. Is that we have to choose whether we're just going to react to the given situation. And, you know, in life and death situations, when it's on the spur, that will save your life. But when you're dealing with how you process an event after the fact, it's so important that we, you know, that we understand that we make a choice as to whether we just react or whether we respond. I think it's so important. Andy Stanley says this, and he says that the right choice can make good things from bad things, can turn wrong things into right things. It actually helps you to thwart evil intentions of evil people. When we choose our response rather than just reacting, and believe me, I know, it feels so natural, and what is natural to us is just to react. It's so different for us to stop, think, pray, respond. But man, when we do that, it's almost like a superpower. Because now it takes, instead of being controlled by the event, we start to take control, maybe not of the event itself, but we start to take control of us and what we do with it. Okay? And so I want you to stay with me here, because honestly, it's more the most natural thing in the world for any of us is to get caught up in any event and then just react. I think what we're seeing today is a lot of people are just taking a glimpse and they're reacting. And I'll be honest with you, most of the time, if not almost every time, my natural reaction, and I want you to take note of that word, natural reaction, is usually destructive. How often have we seen something and it sets off a chain of thoughts in our mind and we have come to a conclusion void of any evidence? And so we react. And in the midst of that reaction, we become destructive. I can't tell you how many times it sickens my heart when I think of how many times I've reacted and I've instead of bringing something good to the situation, I just took a bad situation and I made it worse. I can think of several times. And that's the thing, is that natural, what we do naturally, usually destructive. But when we think and we respond, we can be constructive. It's so important. I mean, I want you to think about a time when you just reacted to what you saw, and then you found out that you didn't see the whole picture. And because you didn't see the whole picture, what you said, it basically made you look like an idiot. You know, there have been times when raising my girls where I reacted to a situation and I went off of what I saw and what I perceived. And then when I found out I didn't have the whole picture, I just went and lit up one of my kids for no good reason or something that wasn't their thought. Or I went to light up somebody else's kids and then I found out that what my kid did, right? And they're part of the story. And I'm going to refrain from telling stories about my kids because I still owe my kids. I'm in debt right now because of reacting or because of the things I've said about the stories I've told. All right. But I want you to think about that because, man, how often have we reacted? And then we found out that we were totally off base on our reaction. And I don't know about you, but for me, those are some of the most shameful moments of my life where I really intensely experience regret is when I just reacted. And so what I'm hoping to do is maybe help you that if you'll take this to heart, that maybe I can save you some embarrassment. I know for myself, I get enough of that in my life. I just assume avoid it if I can. So here's the thing is that when you react, and this is me this time that I'm quoting, but when you get caught up in an event and then you just react to it, you become a victim. You give up all of your power because now you are controlled by it. So the event happens, you react to the event, and that's because now the event controls you. At that point, I've given up all power. I've just went bleh, and I've just went with it. How often do we make ourselves look crazy, stupid, or destructive because we just reacted? What Andy Stanley says about this, and very, very worth listening to, is that when we just react, we relinquish our power, our destiny, our legacy. So everything that we are hoping to achieve when we just react to a situation, we give all that away. And so I want to challenge you, and I mean, honestly, this is, I think, one of the core issues of personal growth. Is that a well-thought-out response, this is Andy Stanley here, can bring redemption and healing to a negative situation. If we'll just simply stop engaging our fleshly response, our natural response, and start stopping and taking a moment. So I want to give you just some keys that if you will actually employ this when you get rocked, and I mean life rocks us all, car accidents happen. Somebody hits us. Maybe we get, you know, we experience a crime committed against us. Things of that nature, when we experience injustice, you know, when life rocks you, and it could be something like a health crisis, you know, when life just throws us a curb, or when we catch what we think we caught somebody at, if we'll just take a moment and push the pause button. And what I mean by that is that you refuse to just bleh and go off. I mean, how often have we responded to a situation and stuff comes out of our mouth and we find out we're wrong and we wish we could rewind all that garbage that we've added to the situation. And so, man, when life throws you and you know, when you're dealing with kids, we have this tendency to just go off and we can't do that. You got to stop and you got to push pause and just wait a minute, okay? And makes me think of Al's song. But with that, you know, give yourself some time so that you're not running on adrenaline or anger or bitterness, but give yourself some time to just chill out and calm down. You know, purposely give yourself some time. I'm learning at this stage of life is that, man, if I just react at the moment, not good, you know, necessarily come from that. But rather, if I'll take set back, and there have been times where I've had things in my nature, my personal nature, is if something's bothering me, I address it right away because in the past I would grind on things and it would actually get worse. More recently in life, I've kind of come into this new era where, you know, rather than just react and think I understand what's going on, I stop, allow my emotions to settle, and actually make a real effort to understand really what's going on here before I just bleh. Learning how to ask questions in the midst of a situation. Ask questions with your mind and ears open to actually hear the answer so that you get a hold of the facts before you just react. Taking time to process and let yourself process it. And now, if you really want to go forward, and especially as a follower of Jesus Christ, stopping, and I've had to deal with this as a leader, is that, you know, you're dealing with people and you wonder, okay, what would be a redemptive outcome? In other words, if a person has done something that has degraded them, sin degrades us. And so what we want to do in our response is that we want to respond in a way that brings redemption, which means, you know, sin degrades us, but redemption gives us our value back. And we want to value people. We want to give them their value back. And if it's a loved one, you know, if it's one of my family, if it's one of my staff, if it's one of my congregation, you know, my goal as a believer should be that I want to see them restored. I want to bring redemption. I want to see them, you know, get their value, their dignity back. That's what we're after here. You know, it's called a life-giving response, and that's something that is pretty core to who we try to be, is that we want to bring life and beauty and redemption to the world and to other people and to situations. That's our goal. And so when I'm looking at my response, I push pause, take a few deep breaths, or take some time to process. And in that time, I make an effort to get the real story, a bit much bigger, better picture before I just respond. And then if I'm really moving in the right direction, I'm like, okay, so what do we want to come out of this? Not what have I lost, what's happened, but rather where can we go in a positive direction from here? What would be a redemptive response? What would be a redemptive outcome so that we end up getting better for this rather than going into and diving into the midst of bitterness? And then the way I respond has to be in alignment with that goal of how can we be better for this. So our responses are in alignment with a goal, and that goal is in alignment with who Jesus Christ is and what the Word of God says, so that we can bring life, redemption, something can be gained for the midst of this pain. And that sounds maybe, any of us who are honest, we know this is crazy hard to do. And I'll be honest with you, early in my life, to stop, think, and respond redemptively was the most unnatural feeling thing in the world. Here's the worst one, and I don't know if it's the same for women as it is for men, but we as men, we feel like we need to take charge and we need to crush them. What you're doing is evil, so I will crush you. I'm going to basically overpower you, whether it be with my words or with my, quote, wisdom or whatever, and I'm going to put you in your place. And I grew up that was the way you did things. And so for me to stop, be thoughtful, and to be redemptive really kind of felt like I was wimping out. And so for me, there was this battle about, you know, being a male and feeling powerful versus trying to bring redemption. And so this is, you know, this kind of response. I mean, I understand the battle. All too often you want to react with a cutting remark or something that just basically smashes your opposition and that makes us, you know, feel powerful and good. But the truth of the matter is most of the time, even if that turns out right, and for me, it always works out so good in my imagination, and then when it comes to real life, it turns out into a total hot mess. So it's so incredible, you know, incredibly hard for us to actually engage and employ this. I don't think I can overstate how unnatural this is. But here's the thing, is that if we are a follower of Jesus Christ, we've been called from the natural to the supernatural. By the power of God's Spirit, when we allow ourselves to yield ourselves to Him, He takes us from natural to supernatural. Listen to this in Galatians 5. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, hatred, discord, fits of rage. You know, fits of rage are natural. That's where my natural flesh wants to go. That's just so easy. It doesn't feel alien or foreign, and it feels powerful in the moment. But natural are the acts of the flesh. But Paul tells us that there's something different about us. The fruit of the Spirit, God's Spirit living in us because we're born again, the fruit of that Spirit that God has put on us is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and here's the one that we need to understand, self-control. Self-control is not our natural state. But self-control is what God's Spirit brings to us. All too often, you know, it gets about us. And unfortunately, most if not all of us have experienced injustice at one time or another. And man, when injustice happens, and including, you know, what we've seen, is that we want to just react to what we see. But you know what? If you call yourself a believer in Jesus Christ, then you want to see how to respond, then the place that we go to naturally and first is that of Jesus. Jesus at the epicenter of his crisis. And the epicenter of crisis and injustice is Jesus. Can you imagine what life was like for him? Here's Jesus, perfectly innocent. Totally powerful. At one point he says, you know, he tells one of the disciples, don't you know that if I could call legions of angels down here to stop this injustice that's being done to him? Jesus experienced injustice. Innocent, he had the power, he could have crushed the Roman legions like that. He was falsely accused. He had done no wrong. The only innocent human being to walk the earth, fully God, fully man, only one innocent. Falsely accused, takes a beating that I don't think many of us could even imagine, crucified the most humiliating, violent, painful death that any of us could imagine. Now, I understand that, and you could be saying, and I would have to agree, I'm not Jesus. You're not, I'm not. But you know what? The Bible gives us other examples of people who have dealt with just the most heinous situations and have chosen the higher ground. And honestly, I've seen people in today's world that have experienced horrendous injustice who have risen up above it and have shown a much higher way. And so as I take you here, I'm going to really urge you strongly, sorry about this, but I want to urge you strongly, don't allow yourself, because whenever we deal with injustice, it's super, super uncomfortable. We hate it. I think most of us are really deeply programmed. We hate injustice. And so we want to skip ahead through the pain to get to the good part. And that's something that just doesn't work. And so I want you to stay with me here and not skip ahead to the end of the story. Exercise some self-discipline with me and follow me as I tell you this story out of the Bible, Genesis 37. You're going to recognize it if you're familiar with the Bible, but it's about Joseph. Now, Joseph was the son of Jacob. And so if you want to know, Abraham was a person that God called out and gave a promise to. Abraham, late in life, had a son, Isaac. And then Isaac had two sons, all right, Esau and Jacob. And so now you've got Abraham, you've got Isaac, you've got Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons, the second from the youngest was Joseph. And he favored Joseph. Joseph was the guy that he really kind of set apart from his brothers. And his brothers didn't much appreciate that. And I can't say as I blame them. But because of this, Joseph being the favorite, the other brothers really kind of looked down on Joseph. He had a little brother, Benjamin. But they really didn't like Joseph very much. Joseph had some big dreams, and he shared those dreams, and they didn't appreciate his dreams very much. So there was this animosity directed towards Jacob. And so now his brothers, verse 12 in Genesis chapter 37. Now his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, Jacob's other name is Israel. And it says this, so, and Israel said to Joseph, as you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. come, I'm going to send you to them. And Joseph, very well, he replies. But now as he's coming out, his brothers saw him in the distance, skipping to verse 18. And before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. So here they are. They see their brother and they're like, hey, we're just going to get rid of him. And they have a plan. They take him. They throw him in a well. His father, because he was the favorite son, gave him this coat of many colors. They had a plot to bloody it up with a goat's blood and say that he'd gotten eaten by an animal. So they throw him in the well. They're planning on killing their own brother. And as they're sitting there eating their meal, they look up and they see this caravan. This is chapter 37, 25. They looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm, and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. And now entrepreneurship enters in. So Judah, not the oldest, but one of the older brothers, said to the rest of them, hey, what do we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he's our brother in our own flesh and blood. And his brothers agreed. Pretty amazing situation. It's like, okay, let's not kill our brother. Let's make some money off him. Awesome. And so can you imagine? Here you are, young man, you go out to see your brothers and your brothers take you and they're planning to kill you. While they're eating, they decide to send you into slavery. So now here's Joseph, sold as a slave. I can't think of anything worse than being a freed landowning person who now finds yourself a slave. And so not only is he a slave to the Egyptians, but the next thing that happens is that he's sold to the Ishmaelites, and now the Ishmaelites sell him, because this is what they bought him for, and they sell him for a second time. So here's Joseph, like a piece of property, who is his father's favorite, goes from being his father's favorite to a slave, and now he finds his second owner. Now Joseph, chapter 39, verse 1, now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, pretty amazing. In the midst of this, here he is, Joseph, free young man, bright future, taken, was going to die, sold to the Ishmaelites, and then sold a second time to Potiphar, captain of Pharaoh's guard, and there he is as a slave. And the Bible says something that I think from our perspective seems so outrageous, that in the midst of Joseph suffering outrageous injustice, yet the Bible tells us that the Lord is with him. And let's be honest, that is so hard for us to accept. Matter of fact, we really do anything we can to avoid taking a hard look at injustice. But here he is, and the Lord's with him. That's the last thing any of us would want to believe in this situation. All too often, when things get hard, we feel abandoned. When things get hard, we have a tendency to lose trust. But here the Bible's very clear that the Lord was with him. And since the Lord was with him, right, that meant that he lived happily ever after, right? Wrong. All too often we think that because we're in relationship with God and our sins have been washed away, now is the beginning of happily ever after. But any of us who've lived any amount of time realize that there are happy times to be sure, and oh, happy day, you know, because Jesus washed my sins away, and that's a beautiful thing, and I'll never lose that. But the thing is that from time to time, things get really, really, really scary, bad, and rough. And so here's Joseph, and the Bible says that God's with him, and the last thing that we expect when we hear that God is with us is for things to actually get worse. But for Joseph, they do. Now, Joseph was well built and handsome. Now, I know some of you out there, you read this and you're like, yeah, why couldn't I have been born rich instead of so stinking good looking? But here's the truth. Joseph had the favor of God. He's a good looking guy and he finds himself a slave. And because of this favor, after a while, his master's wife takes notice of Joseph and said, come to bed with me. Now take a moment and take a hard look at this. Joseph is a slave. But because he rises above and God's favor rests on him, everything that's happening in Potiphar's house that Joseph touched is blessed. So you know what happens if you do good work? You get more work. And so Joseph, because of God's favor on him, Potiphar is prospering. So he puts Joseph in charge of everything because God prospers everything he touches. And so now Potiphar's wife takes a liking to Joseph. Invites him into his bed. And think about this. Here is the slave. Potiphar is the master. And now the master's wife is giving Joseph an order. Come to bed with me. Slaves aren't supposed to say no to the master. Slaves aren't supposed to say no to the master's wife. But Joseph, and what's so beautiful about him, and this is what really tells about our character, is that I can't imagine the height from which he fell and the depth to which he found himself. But he's one of those men and women that are just so incredible that no matter where you put them, they just keep looking up. So here he is. He's doing a great job. He's being faithful as a slave. Now he's asked into his master's wife's bed. And he did the right thing. He refused. Verse 8. But he refused with me in charge. Now he's trying to reason with his master's wife. He says this. With me in charge, he told her, my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns, he is entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, and rightfully so, because you are his wife. Listen to this response. How then could I do, Mr. sold into slavery twice, how could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, he refused to go to bed with her, an intelligent decision, or even to be with her at any level. In other words, he started avoiding her because he knew that she was going to try to draw him into her bed. And so he makes a stand on doing the right thing. His situation, totally impossible. Master, slave. Master's wife says do. He says won't do because I'm going to be faithful to my master. So he chooses integrity with his master, but he goes way beyond that. And this is when we sin against God. And he says, man, how could I do such a wicked thing against God? And some of us are like, you mean the God that allowed you to become a slave? And the answer would be yes. Rather than turn his back on what he knew to be right and good and true with God, he chose to be and to do the right thing, even though the situation he was in was totally wrong. He should not have been in that situation. It was injustice to put him in that situation. He was a victim in this situation. And yet when he was put to the truth or to the test, he chose to do what was right and what was just in God's eyes. We can make excuses for anything, but he chooses to do what's right in God's eyes. And when we start to answer to a holy and a righteous God, it takes everything up to a whole different level. And in spite of Joseph's situation, he chose to do right by the master. He chose to do right by his master and the God of the universe. And what's really sad is that rather than this delivering him at this time, he actually gets punished for doing the right thing. Can you think of anything worse than doing the right thing and getting punished for it? And yet I know it happens. So Joseph's master took him once his wife, you know, he's in the situation. She grabs his clothes, says, come to bed with me. And he does the right thing. This is always the right thing in those situations, is he runs. He runs. She has his cloak in her hand. And she goes and accuses him to her husband. I'm really shocked, honestly, and I see the hand of God here, because normally a slave would be put to death. I have my own personal suspicions that Potiphar had an idea of what the real story was, and he might have talked to other slaves. But so rather than just execute him, which I think would be the normal response to something like this, instead, Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. And you know what? We have no idea what this prison looked like, but one thing I would bet, and that is that it's far worse than what we would come to expect in our day and age. So, but here's the thing. Now, listen to this. Joseph, sold as a slave twice, propositioned by the master's wife, does the right thing, thrown in prison. And what does chapter 39, verse 21 say? The Lord was with him. He showed him kindness. This is God in the midst of, here's the slave, falsely accused, you know, free man sold into slavery, falsely accused, falsely imprisoned for doing the right thing in honoring God and honoring his master. So here he is in prison, and we're told that the Lord was with him and showed him kindness. And here's where the kindness is seen, is that here he is, he has favor in the eyes of the prison warden, and now we see a familiar theme. And so the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in prison. And he was made responsible for all that was done there. So now here's the guy, and it's like, oh, cool, this guy's great. Hey, you just go ahead and do all this while you're here in prison. Because, you know, you do a good job, more work. So the warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care, because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. Here's what's incredible. In the midst of everything that has befallen Joseph, time and time again, does the right thing, gets thrown in prison, and yet Joseph was absolutely certain and knew that God was with him. Now, I don't know about you, but I know what comes to me is like, well, when's he going to benefit from God with him? Because Potiphar benefited, the prison warden's benefit. When is he going to benefit from God being with him? I think a lot of us, we've had that sense that God is with us, and we're like, well, when is it going to benefit us, right? And here's the thing, is that Joseph, in the midst of all this, you know, he didn't have the benefit of a Bible. He didn't have the benefit of having other people to consult with to keep him encouraged. He didn't have a body of believers around him saying, hey, just hang in there. God will come through. Just hold on. He didn't have that benefit. There was no Bible. He didn't have Wifi to where he could go and look up, you know, people's testimonies and stories and get communication off of the internet about how to continue in the faith when everything goes wrong. All he had is the stories that he heard from his father and his family. He had his father's faith, and he refused to let go of it. I think it's incredible in all of this, Joseph was convinced that God was with him. And because he was convinced that God was with him, he could not be touched by his circumstances, because he knew that his God did not and would not abandon him. He was so convinced in the character of his God that no matter what life threw at him, he refused to believe anything other than Emmanuel, God is with us. God is with us. To the point that when later when he confronts his brothers, where he has all of the power, because his character was such that he refused to compromise this idea that I belong to him. And because I belong to him, he is with me and he will not let me go. And no matter what kind of circumstance I find myself in, I will not be lost to my God. And so here he is in this relationship and he's confronting his brothers. He messed with them a little first. I thought he was incredibly kind in messing with them. He has all the power now. And as he's looking at them, he says this. He says, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." And those of you who don't know the story, a severe famine is there. Joseph has risen to the to be one of the most powerful men in Egypt. He is able to bring them out of this incredible famine and keep them covered. You know, his brothers intended to do harm, but God has a way of taking the bad and making it good. Incredible faith. Incredible trust in what would look like abandonment. Here's what I'm hoping that you get out of the time that you've invested in watching this video. Is that we are all called to respond to whatever life throws at us with the conviction that God is with us. See, that's what faith is all about. Do we really trust, expect, and trust that God has not abandoned us? All too often, people turn away because things aren't going the way we expect, and so we assume that God has abandoned us. What would change in your situation right now if you absolutely knew that God is with you? That God's with me. For us, with some of the things that we're facing this year, God is with us. And God is always good. It doesn't always look good. Injustices still can occur. But in the midst of this, God is with us. Can we trust him? What would we do differently if we were absolutely convinced God is with us? That's how we go forward from here. That's how we can stop, think redemptively, get the whole story, respond in a redemptive fashion. God bless you. And I pray that you'll take this to heart. God's with us in everything. Pray with me. Father, we thank you for your goodness, Lord God. We thank you for the reality that we lose sight of so easily. That you're here. And somehow, even through layers of evil, you're able to, just like springing up out of the ground, bring good. Help us, Lord God, to trust you and to go forward and know that goodness comes when we trust you. Pray you'll be with every person here, Lord God. You know their story. You know the hurts. Help us, Lord God, to look to you, to stop, think, get the whole story. And seek, Lord God, to bring goodness, redemption by a thought out, prayed out, faith-filled response. In Jesus' name, amen.